Again, so great to see where you all are joining from, really all across the world. It's a delight to be with you live today, and it is a delight to host today's speaker, Dr. David Murphy. He is a lecturer of history at the National University of Ireland, Maynooth, a graduate of University College Dublin and Trinity College Dublin, where he received his PhD. Murphy has taught courses at both of these institutions on European and Irish history, military history, and the history of polar exploration. Between 1997 and 2005, Murphy was a major contributor to the Royal Irish Academy's Dictionary of Irish Biography, writing almost 400 biographical entries, and was seconded to the Irish Manuscripts Commission. In 2004, Murphy became the first Irish scholar to be awarded a fellowship to the West Point Summer Seminar in Military History. He's a member of various societies, including the Ormond Military History Society. And since 2008, Murphy has served as a reader for academic publishers, including Four Court Presses, Palgrave Macmillan, Yale UK, and Liverpool University Press. He is a member of the Royal United Services Institute and is an external examiner for Department of Defense's Studies, King's College, London. Please join me in welcoming Dr. David Murphy.
Okay, good evening, everybody. I hope you can see me okay. I'm just going to go share screen now. It's we always have these kind of like technical moments with the start of every talk, where we get this moment right. I have to say, I'm one of these people that really, I don't think anybody enjoyed COVID, but I particularly didn't enjoy COVID when I was actually doing my work through this kind of mode. I like to be, I'm a performance animal. I like to be in the space and actually get to talk to people. But listen, I'm delighted to be here this evening. It is a couple of years now since I've last been in Kansas City. I've been over a couple of times, and when I get there, I always try to get to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. If you have not been, you need to go. It is a fantastic museum. I think probably the best World War I exhibition museum that I've actually seen. And I've seen a few, but it's a great location. I was first, relating to tonight's talk, the first time I was actually in Kansas City was actually up at the Commander General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth. And it was to talk about Lawrence. And that is not quite, but almost 20 years ago now. And if we cast our mind back to, it was in around, say, 2007, 2008, there was obviously a lot of interest in the Middle East at that time, considering what was going on. Basically, I was over there. We were exploring the idea of what his leadership style was. How had he been created as a leader, as a kind of like a guerrilla warfare leader? And did that have any applicable lessons to both Afghanistan and Iraq, which is what was kind of the focus of attention in the CGSE at the time? So it's that context. Lawrence is somebody that I return to from time to time. It's one of these situations, every time when I think I'm actually finished talking about him, I get asked to come and talk about him again somewhere else. And I was very glad when Lara reached out to me and asked to talk in this series. What am I going to talk about tonight? We have about 40 minutes. I would say I'll try and touch on all these kind of like ideas, but I just want to look at basically... He is very much an amateur. Lawrence is an amateur, and maybe that's one of the reasons that he shows such talent, I think, in World War One. When he comes in, he's had very little military training per se. He gets into World War One. He's out in the Middle East, and in many ways, he has original ideas. He has not come through the various staff colleges that we see various generals, very disastrous generals of World War One going through. So he's not hidebound. Okay, so he's open to new ideas. He is an interest in people, and I think that's why he operates so well. So I just want to talk about his background into the desert campaign. I'll also touch on the political background to this. And in many ways, we're seeing stuff at the moment on our news streams. We're back into a news stream that's talking about Gaza, Palestine, Israel. In many ways, some of the issues that we're seeing played out today are actually hotwired in the Arab Revolt period, and then the immediate aftermath of World War One, that really the fault lines really begin to emerge then, and we're still dealing with that. There's a couple of debates about Lawrence, about TEL, TE Lawrence. I will try and touch on those as we go, and then also finally, when we get to the concluding phase, this idea of using him as a template for modern officer education, for modern officers working in this kind of environment. This is kind of the area we're going to be looking at today. That is the Ottoman Empire as was, as you can see at its height there, which would be kind of like the kind of territory there, with that kind of like pink area, went all the way into what is now modern day Austria. Okay, modern day Austria, up to the gates of Vienna. Okay, it's that extensive. And it, North Africa, obviously, Egypt was Ottoman territory. Throughout the 18th and 19th century, it starts to get squeezed back out of those spaces. Okay, squeezed out of those spaces. So by the time of World War One, it is only that yellow phase, which is Turkey as we would know it today, kind of like modern Turkey, European Turkey and Asiatic Turkey, but also taking in Iraq or Mesopotamia as it then was, Syria, Lebanon it takes in, Palestine, what is now Palestine, Israel, and then all the way down that strip of coast, all the way down to Yemen. So much reduced by 1914, but even still quite a substantial territory, quite a substantial empire. People had been predicting, you know, European experts had been predicting the end of the Ottoman Empire at this stage for about 50-60 years. Okay, 50-60 years, all the way back to the time of, say, the Crimean War in the 1850s. And everybody reckoned it was going to collapse imminently. It has actually proved to be quite resilient, maybe because it is a bit ramshackle. It's actually quite resilient in terms of World War One. In the course of World War One, there are dramatic phases, as we would know, in Gallipoli. Also, there's a British campaign in Mesopotamia, which now becomes Iraq. Out of Egypt, Palestine, that kind of Gaza line, heading up the coast towards Syria. And then the Arab Revolt. The Arab Revolt is something that kicks off mid-war in 1916, something that had not been planned on the Allied side. Okay, they had facilitated certain activities there pre-war, but it is not part of an Allied plan. And essentially, and I'll explain this hopefully as we go along, they essentially inherit this revolt and they have to do something about it. And that's where Lawrence comes into his own. In terms of desert warfare as well, I think we recognize this now as basically it was a precursor for activities we see in World War II and beyond. I mean, what you see kind of in the desert environments in World War One, we quite often we concentration. I'm sure some of you just were at that 1917 screening. It's an amazing film and it encapsulates the Western Front. But we think about stalemate. We think about mud. We think about barbed wire. Much more movement in the Middle Eastern theater, much more flexibility. And people start thinking about, you know, how do you design your force for this? Okay. You know, basically, in the initial phases, all armies are operating with whatever they have to hand, okay, both the French and the British Army. Whatever we have in this area, in Egypt, etc., and North Africa, we will use. By 1970, 1918, they're tailoring those forces very, very specifically. And some of the lessons they've learned will flow forward to World War II and into modern desert warfare as well, okay? And we see the growth of kind of like specialized equipment. We see specific tactics developing. You know, you've got space, so you basically hotwire that into your strategy. You use that space to do raids, to do hit and run. You know, flanks are more flexible. So it's if you're in the world of kind of like special forces kind of activities, it's quite much more flexible and exciting to work in that environment. And also skills. I mean, the necessary skills. We don't really think about this, but part of the learning curve for all sides. Is teaching their people how to survive in the desert. I mean, they can't be effective militarily unless, of course, they can force survive. So teaching them how to basically travel, how to use water, how to navigate, etc. That we all see all this played out initially in a very amateurish kind of way, but much more polished by the end of World War One, and then that flows forward into World War Two. I should always do this bottom line up front. From the point of view, for a lot of people, Lawrence of Arabia is the movie, is Peter O'Toole. I have had fascinating conversations with some of my students because they had seen the movie or part of the movie, and they thought that Lawrence was a fictional character. the movie quite often gets in the way of the real person. And if it gets in the way of the real person, we should also say, he is the one that gets all the attention post-war and becomes famous and becomes this iconic figure. But there's a whole cast of other officers and people there behind him that are essentially lost in the mainstream debate about this. I mean, that is a subject for another lecture. Maybe somebody has touched on that already. If not, somebody should in a later lecture. But there are a whole cast of people there doing very interesting things, but they are basically subsumed by Delon's character. So that's worth thinking about. And the impact of the film is huge. I love the film. I have to watch it at least once a year. My wife once described it as a very long film in which nothing happens. That's hocus. But there we go. Why did I get interested in Lawrence? I mean, I was interested in him from a very young age. And there is that peculiar, there is a peculiar Irish connection. And I've done some poking around a bit further into this. This is a house called South Hill, which is in County Westmeath in Ireland. It is literally, from where I'm sitting now, it's about half an hour in a car to that location. Okay, it was the home of a man called Sir Thomas Chapman. Sir Thomas Chapman, local landlord, Anglo-Irish landlord, one of the Chapman family, very prestigious Irish gentry family. Married man, he had four daughters. This is one of them here on the back lawn of the house. That house still exists, by the way. And he has four daughters, but he hires a governess, a lady called, we know as Sarah Junner, who will later be known as Sarah Lawrence. Okay. The governess comes to the house to basically educate the young ladies. And it's like some kind of Victorian melodrama. Then Sir Thomas has an affair with the governess. Okay. She falls pregnant. He moves her to a house in Dublin, and essentially there will eventually be five sons from that union. He will leave the wife, he will leave the children, he will leave South Hill, okay? He will leave that location, he will leave Ireland and never come back. And T.E. Lawrence, or Ned as he was known as a kid, is one of those five sons that he has with Sarah Lawrence, okay? So there's that peculiar Irish connection. The four daughters actually survive up until the last of them dies in the 1960s. And I've met some people who knew them and used to work for them, etc. And they went into this peculiar kind of like twilight world. They never married, living in a house at first here and then later in Dublin. Knew about their half brothers, knew about Lawrence, about T. Lawrence, and from what I can see, no side ever reached out to the other to talk. But it's quite a sad story in many, many ways. I would always say at this moment in time, I mean, the area has attracted me. My father kind of like worked out there for a while. He was in one is almost ashamed to say that these days, but he was in an oil company. So he worked out in that neck of the woods. So when I could, I actually went and I traveled. This is actually a photograph I took in Wadi Rum in Jordan, which is a center of action for Lawrence. It's one of his main locations, one of his main areas. At this point in time, I usually encourage people and say, look, go. If you have a chance, go. I don't think that's good advice right now, the way things are. Jordan is probably the safest country in the Middle East. But even at the moment, that whole area is very, very tense. But if you ever do get a chance to go, it is a fascinating experience to travel through these areas, some of which have remained untouched. There's been archaeological work that has found material that was left over. At a couple of different occasions in different places, Bedouin Arab tribesmen actually came and handed me rifles that had been handed down in their family. And when you look at they were stamped 1916, 1917, British Enfield rifles. So it is a fascinating area to go to. Go there when it's safe. But coming back to the Lawrence story, that is Sarah Lawrence with four of her five boys, okay, four of her five boys. The small boy in the sailor suit sat there on the porch with the wee dog beside him. That is T.E. Lawrence, Ned, as he was known. There is another son after this. There is another boy after this, the younger son, Arnold. When you look at the childhood, they moved around quite a bit. Okay, they are bouncing from one location to another. There seems to be a suspicion amongst the boys when they got into their early teens that, you know, there was something unorthodox about their parents' relations. You know, when you think of it, they had on either side. They had no grandparents. They had no aunts, no uncles, no cousins. They exist in the capsule of the Lawrence family. And they eventually come to roost. They come to a full stop in Oxford, which is where his schooling was. He went on to university. And then for a time was working in kind of like archaeology in the Ashmolean, etc. That's him on the left there during kind of like archaeological work pre-World War I. I find myself quite often, I give my students a case study of somebody who basically had a World War I experience. I teach a World War I course. And one of the questions I always ask them to think about, what would their life have been if there hadn't been World War I? What would they have gone on to do? What's highly likely when you look at Lawrence's trajectory at this time, he's going to work in archaeology. He's probably going to end up back working in one of the Oxford colleges. He is in that kind of capacity post World War I for a while. And that is his trajectory. But it's the whole area is so volatile. Even pre-World War I, he gets sucked into as intelligence work. There is a pre-World War I survey of the Sinai Peninsula, the Sinai Desert, conducted by this man. This is Colonel Newcomb, of the Royal Engineers. And essentially, it is an archaeological survey. That is the front. And Lawrence and his companions actually provide that front. But really, it's actually surveying routes from the west to the east, through Sinai, into Ottoman territory. It's a recce. Essentially, it's a recce. Okay. So that's, he begins to operate in that world. And then obviously, World War I breaks out. Now, initially, he's under height. He's only about 5'5". You know, there's also other physical things that, you know, in terms of chest expansion and stuff like that. So he doesn't immediately get accepted into the military. Okay. His two of his brothers do. One is a flyer and the other is an infantry officer. And two of his brothers die in World War One. One goes completely missing on the Western Front and the other is killed and he's buried. We can find his grave. We know where he is. And that obviously had a huge impact on him. And you can see him in the early months of 1914 into 1915 trying to get into the war. Eventually, through personal connections, he ends up in Cairo working in the intelligence section, which is probably just as well, because when you think of it in the context of the time, if he had just been taken and thrown into the regular kind of like officer train, he probably would have ended up dead on the Western Front. But he has one of his college professors, a Professor Hogarth, has got basically a gig in Cairo working in intelligence, and Lawrence goes to join that. And that's where he ends up. Initially, when you look, intelligence always has that kind of like, exciting tone to us. But I mean, quite a lot of what he was doing was quite mundane work. It's interviewing, you know, prisoners of war. It's trying to keep track of what's coming out in Turkish newspapers. It's trying to keep tabs on some Arabian contacts. But it's quite mundane kind of stuff, quite mundane, really. His first kind of real excitement, I mean, if we look at, this is a map of was then Mesopotamia, is now Iraq. That location, if you can see the left-hand panel, there's a town there called Kut al-Amara. And I won't delve into this story hugely, but a British army under General Townsend gets surrounded and cut off there. And Lawrence is sent from Cairo to basically go through the lines to open negotiations with the Turks, with the Ottomans, to try and buy that army back. Okay, he goes and he's authorized to offer so much in gold to buy back the army. And the Turks say, no, we'd rather have the POWs, especially if there's a general POW. We'll take the POWs. Thank you very much. But that's just kind of like that's his first real mission away from the desk into something a bit more exciting. And then in 1916, he will get caught up in the Arab Revolt itself. The Arab Revolt, as I was saying earlier on, this is something that the British and the French, this is an allied effort, okay, and the French, they inherit this, okay. Basically, in the years coming up to World War One, coming up to 1914, there are some specific nationalist movements emerging amongst the Arab populations in the Ottoman Empire. Okay. Most of those are actually urban. They're urban based around urban elites. And they're agitating amongst themselves about how will they gain independence, an Arab nation or Arab nations out of the Ottoman Empire. This gentleman here is Sharif Hussein of Mecca. Before World War One, he opens negotiations with Cairo, with the government in Cairo. At the time, the Governor General is Field Marshal Kitchener, who will go on and have a very significant World War One career, organizing basically the British effort for in the initial years. There's an initial meeting in April of 1914. Aspirations and plans are outlined. And what actually happens in the intervening years is that the British operation in Cairo will send weapons, small arms, okay, rifles, etc., to the Arabian Peninsula, to Sharif Hussein and his family and his sons. And then also they send in a lot of gold, a lot of money, okay, into Arabia in that pre-war phase. And then what we see in come 1916, the Ottomans obviously know something's going on. Come 1916, a clampdown begins in what is now Syria, and Sharif Hussein thinks that he's got to be swept up in this clampdown. So they begin a revolt in June of 1916. The Ottomans even have this other chap, Sheriff Haider, Ali Haider, to actually take over at Mecca. So it's all that kind of internal politics in the Arab, the Muslim world. But Hussein is hand is forced, and we have a rebellion on our hands. Reckon in terms of numbers, the upper estimate says around 30,000. And there's a question mark behind us. It's very hard to count and keep track of these people, but in around 30,000. Now, when you look at this map, kind of, that's the Arabian Peninsula. You can see there's two blue locations. That's the Sharif Faisal up at Medina, and further south at Mecca, we've got Hussein. And everything else is red, is Ottoman. Okay. You can see they control the railway, which is that black line snaking south. They also control all the major ports. Numerically, there's much more of them. Okay. So what we see is the situation. How would you turn that map around? And that is what is initially presented to not only Hussein and his sons, but also by consequence to British and French generals and British French leadership here. In terms of the Arab leaders, we have Hussein, obviously, and he has a series of sons. There's an Ali, there is also an Abdullah, and third son is the man on the left here, is Faisal. And Allied attention focuses in on Faisal, because what they realize is that both Ali and Abdullah want to stay put in around Mecca, because they reckon that that's where the end game is going to be. If this succeeds, they want to be in around Mecca and to take up political office or whatever in that kind of context. Faisal, as the third son, is a bit to one side. He's not going to inherit anything nice and interesting. So the Allies focus in on him, enable his army, his force, because they reckon they will get flexibility out of him. And if they will actually kind of like politically, and Lawrence will play a part in this, they will direct him northwards, okay, where it's the best use to the Allied army as well. There are other people involved in this. The man kind of like in the right-hand picture, the man laughing, wearing the Arab headdress, is a man called Jafar Pasha al-Askari. Jafar Pasha al-Askari. He's an Iraqi officer. He is in the Ottoman army. He's been taken POW, and then he is flipped. He's flipped by the British side, and he will come back and be an officer then in Faisal's army, in the Arab army. Okay, there are several officers who are of similar kind of like background, who are initially Ottoman trained. Some of them were even through the German colleges, the German military colleges, but the British have actually succeeded to flick them, and they're now going to work on their side in this kind of context. So the leadership, you have this quite often again, the focus on the Arab side focuses in on Faisal as the charismatic figure, but there are other people in the melt here as well, some of them who are very well trained militarily, and they will play a part. And then also, obviously, the tribal leaders are going to play a huge role in this. And Lawrence will become involved in this from October 1916 onwards. Okay. Now, the rebellion breaks out in June, and it's up and running, and it's in, you know, it's actually in difficulties. And then in October, Lawrence will show. And his role in this, well, he emerges because he's worked pre-war in the area. He has the language. He has languages, a couple of different dialects of Arabic, so he can communicate to people. And he also understands the shorthand. he recognizes tribal differences. He recognizes currents and patterns of power within tribes and leadership. He knows how to handle these people, as we would say today. He can speak to them, he can handle them, and he becomes, at the time he's only a lieutenant, his kind of like his promotion prospects in World War One are quite spectacular. He starts, so he's a lieutenant or a lieutenant in the American system. By the end of the war, 2 years later, he's a full colonel. Okay, so lieutenant, captain, major, half colonel, colonel, and that's quite spectacular. But it reflects the increasing importance he plays in this. As I said earlier on, that's another map which just shows a couple of the significant ports, Rabegh and Yanbu. Again, the red lines there indicate essentially Turkish counterattacks. By the end of 1916, by December of 1916, it looks like this whole thing is going to be snuffed out because they've pushed the Arab armies back to these ports. Okay, the only thing that turns it around is the Royal Navy and also Royal Navy air power. They fly seaplanes in and they start strafing basically Turkish forces on the ground. So that's what turns it off and saves it in that time, Royal Navy power, and also Royal Navy ships covering those two ports. But it looked like something that had kicked off in June and was going to be over by Christmas. But they begin to turn that around from late 16 onwards. Now, Lawrence, excuse me, just having a quick drink there. He is significant in all this. And he's significant in all this because he really codifies how a main phase of this campaign is going to develop. There is always a certain amount of conventional military operations going on, both in Palestine, up further north, and then also even in Arabia. The forces that will line up, the British and the French, will have conventionally styled forces there. But then this other element, okay, and I'm sure your people can read the screen, this idea of, using the space, using the surprise, the idea of detachment. I mean, when you look at kind of Western generals, especially on the Western front, the whole idea of having to be constantly in contact with each other, with the enemy army, knowing where it is, trying to break it, etc. Whereas this idea of just being a mobile force, essentially, in the desert, identifying the weak spots, hitting the weak spots, and then disappearing again. It ties down, and for anybody who's been in the military or kind of like is keen on our military, kind of like the military history, you can recognize this idea. We've seen it so many times before, so many times afterwards. The force that just cannot be caught, that is moving around in space, and it really ties down troops. It has been suggested this man, Al-Masri, again, Ottoman officer, an Iraqi Ottoman officer, Lawrence knew him. And we know now that he had actually laid down a very similar idea to what Lawrence eventually uses. He talks about a small light force, with maybe armored cars, maybe with armor, light armor, and mobile artillery. He actually puts, there's a question there. Did Lawrence knew him? Lawrence traveled out to Arabia with him on the same ship. Did Lawrence take his idea and run with it? Or is this independent? Kind of like independent development of an idea. You can decide that yourself. But Masri's ideas and Lawrence's ideas are very, very close together. And the French, I'm not going to delve deep into the French today, but they are there too. They are there too. As I said, this is an Allied operation. The rather large gentleman there, kind of like, second from the right in your screen wearing the kepi, that is Colonel Brémond. Colonel Brémond is the head of the French mission to the Arabs. Okay, the French bring a certain amount of troops. They bring a certain amount of equipment. Like the British, they're spending an awful lot of money. Okay, an awful lot of gold, French Louis d'Or money. Kind of gold coin. They have significant advantages from the point of view that because of their North African territories, they have regiments made up entirely of Muslim soldiers. They have officers of the French army who are Muslims, and they can operate in around Mecca. Okay, there's no prohibition on them being in around the holy cities, Mecca and Medina. Many of the British units, even the units they bring from Egypt, they may have Muslim troops, they may have some Muslim officers, but the senior officers in those battalions and those regiments would be British officers. Okay, so the French have a little bit of an edge here. But to a certain extent, that works against them. They remain focused in on Medina and Mecca as the political capital. And then there's also a large Turkish force at Medina that they will contain. And they will essentially stay in what is now Saudi Arabia. They will actually stay there for much of the rest of the war. Whereas the British mentality, the British strategy, is to get this whole thing moving and start pushing it up northwards to benefit the major, the main campaign. So the French are there too. We shouldn't forget the French. And I should point out that Lawrence absolutely hated them. He despised them and tried to undermine them every chance he could. But there we go. That's the whole British-French thing there now. We all know about that. And it's a significant thing that everything focuses on here. And it's quite interesting. That kind of like, that's the Ottoman Empire again. And I hope you can see that kind of like snaky hatched line, that kind of like line running around it from Constantinople, and it goes up to Bulgaria, Romania. But the significant one is the one that comes south through Syria, Palestine, and is heading off down into what is now Saudi Arabia. It is then referred to as the Hejaz. That is the Hejaz Railway. It is a German-built railway. Okay, and basically, all reinforcements, all supply for the Ottoman army has to move south along that. If they are to maintain those that presence in Syria, Palestine, Lebanon, they need this railway. Okay. And further on south, they desperately need this railway. It's a single track railway. Okay. Basically, it works that, you know, say Monday, Wednesday, Friday, a train goes south on it. Kind of like Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, the train goes north on it. It's that kind of a deal. You can't have two trains running in opposite directions, a single track railway. And Lawrence focuses in on this, and several other British officers focus in on this. And they realize that if they actually mess this up, if they keep breaking this, it ties down a huge amount of Turkish manpower to actually guard it, garrison it, and patrol it. It also takes up huge resources to fix it when they break it, okay, when they blow it up. And also it means that by the end of the war, the big Turkish garrison down in Medina, which is nearly 20,000 soldiers, they can't reinforce it. They also can't evacuate it. Okay, they don't have lift capacity on that railway to get everybody out at the same time. Okay, so those 20,000 guys are stuck there. Okay, and basically the railway campaign is a way of keeping them out of everybody's hair for the north. So to get into this kind of like process of sometimes quite big parties going out, this is, as you can see, 500 charges blown up over a number of days on this railway. People who've seen the movie, you get this idea of Lawrence going out, planting one bomb, detonating one bomb. It's much more elaborate than that. It's like basically destroying kilometers of railway at specific times. And the ways to go about doing this, blowing down bridges, blowing curved sections of track, because they realize it's harder to replace them, to get those curved rails. It's harder to get those. So that's where we focus on. And then they also develop what's known as the tulip mine, which basically blows the tracks up into a kind of, they're still connected, but blows them up into the air in this kind of like tulip shape, like a tulip bulb, which then means you have to dismantle that before you repair that. So there's real kind of like messing with people's heads, a lot of psychological warfare here. But it's very, very interesting campaign. And if you travel there, that railway, I mean, there's been various attempts to get this up and going. The Jordanians have a section of it up and going. You can travel it again, a certain section out if you wish. But you will find locations where basically locomotives were blown off, damaged, and couldn't be salvaged, and they're just lying there. And also even stuff that wasn't destroyed, there's a certain amount of this rolling stock, this archaic rolling stock, in stations in both Saudi Arabia and Jordan, pushed into one side, no longer used. The Jordanians do run a couple of trains, but essentially it's you can see it, you can actually follow it, follow the line, and follow the damage if you want to do so. And in terms of the raiding parties themselves, some of them are quite big. You know, you would have a small corps of officers, you know, maybe six, maybe half a dozen, maybe a dozen officers, 50 tribesmen, 100 tribesmen, 200 tribesmen. Others are much smaller. This is Lawrence, the right-hand figure on this slide. That's Lawrence preparing to go out with just two other officers. They're going to go out, three of them, four of them, bring camels, bring dynamite, and they're going to go out and blow up the railway. So you're getting from quite big raiding parties down to something like a modern A-team, to use that American kind of expression. But, you know, four or six guys going out to do this kind of work. You can see people are checking their weapons. If you look closely in Lawrence, you will see that he's, if you look at a detail of that photograph, you will see that he's actually loading up a Colt Model 1911. This is for the gun nuts in the audience. His favorite pistol was the Colt Model 1911. Okay, and that has actually led to, in an archaeological point of view, that's actually led to a couple of occasions where we know he was in a certain location because they found spent rounds out of a Colt Model 1911. So there you go. That's a an esoteric factor. No extra charge for it. Now, boy, so you can see by 1918, the map has changed. And what had been red is now blue, okay, in that southern section. Basically, Arab troops, aided by French, aided by British, have actually, and now dominating Arabia. That garrison at Medina, that I mentioned earlier on, that will essentially be trapped there until 1919. The war will be over before that surrenders. Okay, that's a whole different kettle of fish. And then in the kind of like the summer of 1917, the focus shifts up north there to that port town of Aqaba. And they decide that that is the last Turkish port on the Red Sea. And if they take that, not only will they deny access to the Turks to the sea, but also that will facilitate a push up to the north, up to the northeast, heading up towards Palestine, heading up towards Syria. So they go for that. Lawrence decides to go for that. And it's he takes a very, very small party. He kicks off from that location there. It's marked one on that map. It's the town of Wej. Strikes off through the desert. It's a 60-day march. And then comes in onto Aqaba from behind. It's in the movie, it's a famous section, and they have that whole desert phase. But it's an inspirational idea. It's an inspirational idea. And not giving away my end argument here either, but that kind of idea of the long range raid you will see replicated again in World War II. I mean, if you talk to historians of the SAS and you look at their desert raids in North Africa in World War II, they will admit that this is inspirational for them. That's a photograph Lawrence took himself. Really, it's against all military regs to be carrying around a camera and a military operation. But he took that himself as he went into Aqaba. He was a keen photographer, as was his father, actually. And then how does it play out? I mean, what you see then, by this stage, the Arab Northern Army, whose titular commander is Faisal, is Prince Faisal, has this kind of like, it is really two entities here. You have what is known as the Arab Regular Army. Most of them are former Ottoman POWs. They've turned over. They're being officered by former Ottoman officers, okay, with a cohort of British troops and British officers above that. Lieutenant Colonel Joyce is commander of this section. His second in command is Jafar Pasha, the man I mentioned earlier on. So you have a mix of British officers, former Ottoman officers, and basically formed up as a regular force, you know, infantry, cavalry, some light artillery. And then with Lawrence, you have this other irregular contingent that can number up to 6,000 tribesmen. And it's all focused on Lawrence and a few other of the British officers and the tribal leaders. So you've got within the Arab Northern Army, two distinctly different cohorts operating quite differently as the war goes on. They will play an increasingly big part. We're moving up. This is the senior British commander in the area, which is General Allenby. General Allenby, known as the Bull Allenby. Apparently he would roar like a bull when he got angry, the Bull Allenby. Cavalry officer. He is pushing along that coastline. In this phase, between 1917 and 1918, the British Army will fight three battles of Gaza. We're in a battle for Gaza as we speak, but they're actually three battles for Gaza. And they're pushing along the coastline. Their focus is on Jerusalem, which they take in December of 1917, and then Damascus. They want to push on to Damascus. To the right of that screen, you've got the big lakes there, you've got big water features. The Arab army will operate in that area, okay, way over on that right flank. And the whole idea, they are tying down troops that will now not be used against Allenby as he pushes up that coastal route. I hope that makes sense. And then also the troops that are held down in Arabia are not coming to reinforce the, it's the Ottoman Fort Army. They're not coming to reinforce that. So the Arab troops are actually catching a whole load of Ottoman forces and keeping them out of the main effort. Now, there's some political difficulties here, because this rears its ugly head, the Sykes-Picot Accord, Sykes-Picot Agreement. I find this fascinating. I talk to students and they've no idea what the Sykes-Picot Agreement is. And then you see kind of like videos of people from Islamic State, the Islamic State organization, knocking down border markers and ranting and raving about Sykes-Picot, that they're ending Sykes-Picot. Essentially, when the war starts, the leaders come together. They reckon that this war is, the World War One is going to finish the Ottoman Empire. Okay. And predominantly the French and the British, but also the Russians, begin negotiations of who will get the divvy out when this is gone. Who's going to get what out of Turkish territory? Okay. By kind of like middle of 1916, they have an agreement, and that's known as the Sykes-Picot Agreement. It's Georges Picot for France and it's Mark Sykes for Britain, Sykes-Picot. And the idea will be that after the war, France will get Syria and Lebanon. Britain will get Transjordan, what is now Jordan. They will also get Iraq, what becomes Iraq, was Mesopotamia then. They will also get Palestine, okay? And the Russians will also get territory. They are signatories to this too, kind of like in around European Ottoman territories, and also where they abut the Ottoman Empire. Now, because of the Russian Revolution, that kind of agreement becomes public. The Bolsheviks make that public in November of 1917. So suddenly the Arabs realized that, actually, hang on, we were kind of on board with this, because we were told they were backing air rebellion and we were moving towards a new nation state or new nation states. And actually, we're just going to be handed over to the French and the British. Okay. And then there's this also the what's known as the Balfour Declaration. British politician Lord Balfour comes out and says that basically Britain would support a Jewish state in the Middle East. Okay, so we've got a couple of these things suddenly drop into the conversation, the political conversation in late 1917, and everything stops. Okay, everything stops. The whole thing starts falling apart. It looks like the Arab troops are going to mutiny. British officers start kind of immobilizing their own artillery and trying to get back weapons. So how do we get this back on the road again? A couple of different things happen here. First of all, And also the question here about Lawrence, and you can read this. This is a letter actually written in June of 17, before this information has become public. And he's talking about kind of like giving up, going off and trying to get himself killed. They're fighting for us on a lie and I can't stand it. And that, of course, raises the question of when did Lawrence know? Okay, Lawrence know. Basically, the whole world knows by November of 1917. We know that he knew beforehand. Okay, which is why he is personally so disillusioned by the summer of 1917. So how do you get out of this fix? Once again, America has to play a hand here. And one of the things that takes the heat amazingly out of this problem is Wilstein's 14 points, basically on the future self-determination of nations that are in the Ottoman and the British Empire, not the British Empire, Freudian slip there, Ottoman Empire, German Empire, et cetera, et cetera. And these kind of statements are used to say, look, this trumps anything that's come beforehand. The Americans are now major players in this. On the far side of this war, something else is going to have to happen. So that is used. And then also kind of in quite late in June of 1918, the two significant leaders, Faisal there on your right and Chaim Weizmann on the left, major Zionist leader, are brought together at a meeting in the desert, in Jordan. And they have a conversation. And there's a modus vivendi there. So that kind of gets things restarted. But there's a hump of maybe 4 or 5 or 6 months where activity essentially is shutting down. But then it gets going again. When you look at kind of Lawrence himself, I would just throw this in here that the veracity of some of the stuff he talks about has been questioned. It's a peculiar, from speaking as a historian, his story has actually created such a wealth of literature. most of it largely based on his own writings and his own letters. He is the primary source for his own life. Okay, if it was anybody else, we wouldn't accept that kind of situation, but we have. And how he kind of like talks about things like the Deraa incident, where he's captured and, according to his own account, subjected to a sexual assault, and beaten and tortured. There's questions about, did that happen, at least at that time? We reckon now that something happened. We're not entirely sure it happened at that time. The execution of Ghazim, there's question marks about that. So he has been brought into doubt in terms of some of the veracity of some of his own writings and how he displays himself. Looking forward to kind of like the final phase of the war, I was saying, like, in terms of things like force design, it's interesting within the whole system what troops are used and what equipment is used. This is a famous kind of like Lady Butler painting. Lady Butler is a famous Irish woman artist. But the charge of the Dorset Yeomanry, as you can see, this is in the Middle East. This is in the Middle East. When we think of the Western Front, cavalry has no use. Cavalry has no use, really. Can't be used because of the conditions. But you do see them used, and yeomanry troops in particular, in the Middle East, and also Australian Night Horse. In both cases, you're looking at mounted troops who will quite often arrive mounted, dismount the fight, you know, fighting like classical dragoons kind of idea, much more flexible. So it comes as a surprise and a relief to actually have a use for these kind of troops. Other aspects start to get factored in more and more. Air power becomes hugely significant by the end of the war. It's something we don't factor in at all when we think about World War One, about Lawrence of Arabia. Initially, what we see, it's all very amateurish. A lot of the planes that are sent out by both sides are planes that are obsolete on the Western Front, but they have a second life in the Middle East because there's less opposition air, there's less anti-aircraft, et cetera, et cetera. So you can actually use them. And then by the end of the war, they're much more sophisticated. That's a Bristol fighter, an FE-2B, which is top tier. It's a top tier kind of like platform by 1918. How these are used for ground attack, reconnaissance, kind of like bombing missions, strategic bombing missions, very, very interesting. And also the idea of, you know, to increase their reach by laying in airfields and petrol depots in places in the desert. So these can fly, they can refuel, they can fly again. These are all things we would see replicated in World War II. But the beginning of it is now in this time, 1917, 1918. And also this, kind of the use of vehicles, Rolls-Royce cars, Rolls-Royce armored cars, and then tender, kind of like, you know, Crossley tenders. By air eyes, when you see these vehicles now, and I've been got up close to a Rolls-Royce armored car. Very, very primitive, very primitive. But in their context, I mean, a Rolls-Royce armored car has a heavy machine gun in it. It has armor. It means you can basically move up to a Turkish position, stand off and lay down fire, okay, and be bulletproof, okay, bulletproof. And Lawrence starts traveling with these. He likes to move with these through the desert, that bit of mobile firepower. And also on some of the other vehicles, they would lay in mortars and light artillery. So again, you're bringing firepower. And then desert depots, the desert supply, some of these locations. One of these locations was found again about 5 years ago in a very remote area in Jordan. But some of these locations still exist. But the mobility, the firepower, again, we'll see that return to in World War II. And what that actually upguns them, there's a specific incident in a location called Hafila, which is in the Old King's Highway up towards Amman in Jordan. And essentially, Lawrence and his forces take a town. They are counterattacked by a Turkish brigade, and they beat the Turkish brigade. Okay, and this is seen as a crucial moment where the Arab forces are actually in a condition where they can actually stand toe-to-toe with Turkish regular troops. Okay, and not just hit them and melt away, but hit them in a stand-up fight. So it's a very significant action. And then by the end of the war, you have this kind of like, this is the, on the coastal route is the main kind of like British effort, okay? And then that cuts in and starts moving up towards Damascus. And on the right-hand side, I won't dwell on this map too long, but you've got a lot of other activity there. That is the Arab army moving up to the right-hand side of the main British and French effort heading up towards Damascus. Lawrence's war essentially ends when he hit Damascus in October of 1918. A few days after this, British cavalry and Arab tribesmen take a railway junction to the north of Damascus at a place called Muslim Maya. Once you take Muslim Maya, essentially you have the railway line, excuse me, they cannot send anything down to Mesopotamia anymore, Iraq. The Turks also can't get down to their troops in Arabia anymore. So it's over. It's game over at that point in time. Damascus, and then immediately afterwards, the railway junction. The war has been taken out of Ottoman hands. And you will have a Turkish armistice before the armistice with the Germans and the Austrians. The Turks are out of the war. In many ways, that's a huge success. That is a huge success, and it gives us lessons to go forward. The aftermath, though, looks very, very messy. We have, as I said, there's an Ottoman garrison in Medina passed beyond the end of the war. They refuse to surrender. They will only surrender to British troops. Okay, they will not surrender to Arab troops. And so they linger on there till 1919. The political ramifications of this are disastrous, really. And we're still feeling the echoes of this. At the Versailles Treaty, the Arabs go, Faisal goes to try and basically get autonomy. That doesn't work. There's a San Remo Treaty that tries to sort out what's going to happen with former Ottoman possessions. And remember at this time as well, the Ottomans under Ataturk they're not the Ottomans anymore, they're the Turkish Republic, are pushing back. So that's all very, very untidy. Cairo Conference in 21, trying to sort it out. But ultimately what we get is the mandate system. We actually get Sykes-Picot. And in the immediate, kind of like the early 1920s, Britain is confirmed as the mandate holder for Transjordan, which is now Jordan, Palestine, okay. And Mesopotamia becomes Iraq, okay, and they take over, Britain takes over Iraq as well. And France will get Syria, France will get Lebanon. And you've got all of these ethnic and religious divides and fault lines within those territories. You've got all these pre-war aspirations for a different political outcome that are not satisfied, and that leads, I think, into discontent in the 20s, 30s, 40s, and here we are, we're still going on. That's Faisal in Iraq. Faisal is somebody who wants to be king. He wants to be king of Palestine. He is briefly king of Syria, and he will end up as king of Iraq. That becomes his consolation prize. That's Gertrude Bell there on the left. Famous again, a famous Arabist and explorer who knew Lawrence, and she essentially designs the new Iraqi administration. So that's, you know, that's Faisal. That's Faisal's story. And also bear in mind as well, people, you know, the Faisal it represents and Hussein represent the Hashemite regime, and it's still a Hashemite kingdom in Jordan. It's that side of the family. And people often ask, well, where did the Sauds come from? Where does Ibn Saud come from? And Saudi Arabia. Britain is playing both sides of this kind of like discussion. They also are at the same time are courting the family of Ibn Saud. At the time, it's just territory. Ibn Saud will become the major family in around Mecca and Medina. They will push the Hashemites out in the 1920s. They're quite a resilient kind of like force. And then, of course, in the 1930s, we know they discover oil there, and Saudi Arabia becomes very, very important to everyone. So as well as kind of like supporting the Arab Revolt and the Hashemite cause, Britain in particular is also supporting the House of Ibn Saud. This is a photograph taken in 1919. And the young gentleman kind of in Arab headdress at the back is Faisal Ibn Saud, who will go on to be king of Saudi Arabia. This is a PR tour. They have actually brought these people to keep them happy, to keep them on side. They've brought them in wintertime for a hunting trip around Ireland. This photograph is taken in Wexford in November of 1919, which is why I think some of those people look very, very cold. But that's how you make friends. That's how you make friends with the Ibn Sauds. Lawrence as well, the war ends, and he was really largely unheard of. It is this gentleman, it's an American connection, the man here beside him, Lowell Thomas, has developed a movie called With Allenby in Palestine. And he shows this in London, and he realizes that actually what people are interested in, he has a snippet with Lawrence and tribesmen, and he realizes that people are actually interested in Lawrence. So he rejigs the film and releases it again as Lawrence, with Lawrence in Arabia. And that's really where the myth is born. That's where it starts happening. And all of a sudden, he goes from being an obscure character to being an iconic figure of the early 20th century. And we're still, here we are, still talking to him. But it's an American, it would be too reductive to refer to him just as a journalist. He's much more than a journalist. But it's Lowell Thomas that he actually basically launches Lawrence onto the world. And then Lawrence's own books are still available. They're a huge success at the time. Seven Pillars of Wisdom, originally a subscribers only kind of edition. A Revolt in the Desert, an abridged version of that. But they're still available. Seven Pillars is a tough read, but it's worth it. Revolt in the Desert is the highlights. So you can come in via that way if you wish. And then also, I mean, in early 1920s, a fascinating figure to the British public. It's hard to explain this, but when you think about it, you know, so many men, young men have died in the Western Front and died in the war totally anonymously. And they've achieved essentially, you know, nothing personally. And then all of a sudden the public is presented with a story of a single individual who has done so much. Okay, single individual. And that's why there's this focus and this excitement, and on it goes. His later years, you can really see he goes to a phase where he's working for the British Foreign Office. He has a fellowship in Oxford. He's been courted by military commanders as well. And there's a phase where he could really, you know, I always think this up until about 1922, he could really be anything he wants to be. He could be a political figure. He could be a diplomatic figure. He could go back into the military. He could decide I'm going back to my academic life. And he basically turns his back on all of that and goes into the RAF as an enlisted man. Okay. An enlisted man. And it's interesting. His father dies in 1919, and the whole family story pours out then. And you see from that time onwards, there's references, as you can see in this letter here, references to Ireland. Joyce, he had served with Joyce in the war. This is Colonel Pierce Charles Joyce, who's from Galway. And there's references to that. Now, according to local lore and a couple of artifacts, he actually does visit Ireland in the 1920s sometime. But I cannot confirm that. But I will try to. And then 1935, as we all know, killed off a motorbike accident. So from obscurity into the world, global limelight by the end of World War One and directly after World War One, and then back into obscurity after that. A couple of concluding ideas. What can we actually say? Can we say about him? And this comes back to my talk so many years ago up in the CGSC when we were actually looking at him as a model. Obviously, being able to handle tribal leaders, and that takes languages. It also takes cultural awareness. And we could see, I mean, I was involved in a project as well in the UK after this. You can see more and more emphasis in trying to train young officers into not only picking up languages and places they may go, but having more cultural awareness so as not to do the wrong thing, I think in terms of strategic ideas are frankly brilliant in the context of where he's operating in World War One. They're so applicable. And he is, I think, recognisably seen as one of the greats in terms of forming up ideas of asymmetric or guerrilla warfare or irregular warfare, whatever you want to talk about. A couple of caveats to throw in on top of that. I would think about his own writings. You know, he wrote about himself. He wrote well about himself. I would, you know, there are some question marks there. There's also some questionable behavior. There are two specific incidents where under his command, POWs are executed. Okay, one is at Halatama and the other is at Tafas. So we've got two POW outrages where he was involved. Okay, that's worth thinking about. And that point I made earlier on, the originality of his ideas, there's a question mark over that. So maybe he didn't kind of like entirely come up with the idea himself, but he definitely put the ideas into action himself very, very effectively. And he was also the best prophet for those kind of ideas, the best salesman for those ideas. Going forward, and just a couple of last ideas, just very quickly, those interwar years, this gentleman left, Ralph Bagnold, does quite a bit of exploration in around Jordan and beyond, and then into kind of like the western desert of Egypt in the interwar years, in the 20s and then the 30s. And he's written about this, written extensively. And he explicitly says that Jordan, you know, that all his exploration was inspired by Lawrence. Okay, inspired by Lawrence. When you get into World War II, Bagnold is one of the founders of Long Range Desert Group that then facilitates the SAS, Special Air Service, in all of those desert raids in North Africa during World War II. So there's a DNA, there's a genealogy back from basically SAS crews driving out the German airfields and shooting them up in the early 1940s in kind of like North African theater of operations. It goes all the way back to Lawrence, okay, and those kind of moves he made during World War One. Okay, I mean, that's the last thing I want to say about that. I would just leave it on that slide there. That idea of most of us come through this through the film. The film is great, it's a great watch, but there are layers of other activity and meaning going along there behind all of this that's worth considering. I should leave it at that. I'll plug my own books and see if anybody has any questions for me.
David, thank you so much. And yes, indeed, if I'm not mistaken, the Arab Revolt is in our museum store, and we would certainly encourage you to pick that up wherever you are able. Both of the books. I'm going to go ahead and kick off with our first question. This comes from Kevin Winter, and it is a difficult one. David, in your opinion, are there ramifications of World War One that are influencing what is happening today in Israel-Gaza? Were the decisions taken against TEL's advice then affecting what is happening now?
Yeah, I think the quick answer to that is absolutely yes. Yeah, it is yes. I mean, the conversations that the Arab leaders have, not only with him, but with other serious people in the system in World War One, suggest that the Arabs are going to be given autonomy. How that's going to work out, it's difficult to see in terms of how it'll break down, in terms of some areas being under tribal leaders, other forms of government in urban centres, so on. But that is what they're aiming for, and that is the conversation they believe they're in. Okay, and that is not honoured. Essentially, is not honoured. He flags it in various conversations. He flags it in newspapers. He flags it at the Cairo conference, etc. That this is going to happen, and he's not alone. There are other officers. I mentioned that gentleman, Colonel Joyce, Pierce Charles Joyce. He has it's called the 1919 memorandum, and it actually starts out. He actually says, "Look," he says, "we're storing up problems for the future." He says, "We're laying down the lines for future problems here because we're not giving them what we promised." We're kind of like moving them from Ottoman to French and British kind of like, governorship. It's not what he wanted. And then even how things play out and the mandates. I mean, there's been a lot of conversation in the last kind of like month or so about the Palestine-Israel situation. I mean, in the 1920s, we start seeing more and more Jewish settlement into British mandated Palestine. And even at that early phase, there are attacks by Arabs and Jewish settlers, and there are reprisals back against Arabs. It's a small scale kind of stuff, but that kind of discontent and the bloodshed starts in the 1920s, and we're still trying to get out of that problem. We cannot effectively find a way. And then numbers of Jewish settlers increased, and obviously post World War One or post World War Two, and then went into a Jewish state, into an Israeli state, and it's very, very difficult. But it all comes back to that. To that initial phase in the 1920s, just not dealing with the aftermath properly.
Mm-hmm. Stephen Grossman from New York asks, did Lawrence have a position on the Balfour Declaration?
Well, his position on the Balfour Declaration is, I think, is simply this. And this is also, I'll have to say, is Faisal's position. They reckon that, yes, the Jewish people should be welcomed back and they should have kind of be integrated into an Arab state. Okay, so they're seeing kind of, you know, that the, and Faisal says this as well, that they have a valuable part to play in any future Arab state. But it's in that context. It's in the context of Arab state with a Jewish population. Very much, I mean, you know, the Jewish population existed in the Ottoman system as well. I mean, the Ottomans are reasonably tolerant to Jews and various types of Christians. Now that's a pendulum that could swing as we see what happens to the Armenians. The Armenian Christians are suddenly identified as a non-group during World War One, and we have a genocide of Armenian Christians. But that kind of idea, where you have this population, mostly Arabs, Jewish population there as well, yeah, they can exist with us. But the idea of them taking precedence in the system in the area is neither one that supported that. But they didn't think, they never imagined it was actually going to happen. You know, they just thought they'd have a Jewish population.
John Winterburn asks, David, Faisal and Weissman met at Wahid, I hope I said that correctly, in 1918. Do you know what they discussed?
Yes, I do. Yes and no. We have one account of that meeting. And again, the man, I actually have a photograph of it here on my shelf. The man who facilitates the meeting is Colonel Joyce. I should really be talking about Colonel Joyce tonight. Colonel Joyce leaves us the one account we have of that meeting. And he stands up and basically he says that Weissman basically came away from the meeting thinking that the Jewish position was assured, they would have settlement in the area after post-war. And Faisal's position was that, yes, they would welcome Jewish people in, but it would be part of an Arab state. Now, there's a certain amount of ambiguity in that statement, but that's the one account we have of that meeting. And there's a gray space there, and into that gray space is what stuff. I mean, Joyce is empowered to bring them together and let them talk and translate from everywhere else. He doesn't seem to be empowered to kind of like say what the official position is. So they both come away from that meeting thinking that they kind of got what they wanted. And that doesn't play out, you know.
Oh, that happens quite a bit in the end of World War One. Jeff Witskin, in the Silver Pillars of Wisdom, Lawrence describes how he rethought his tactics while laid up sick partway into the campaign. In your research, did you see him make this dramatic change in his methods?
I think yes. I think overall you can see this. There's a shift. He starts shifting to the asymmetric after that. And I know the period, I mean, it's a quite graphic period. He's laid up with diarrhea and God only knows what's, you know, all kinds of stuff going on. But he has, a number of days in a tent reassessing his life decisions. I think you can see his decision to move. And it kind of plays the things he likes. He also likes cars. He likes planes. And when you look at some of the papers, there's a collection in London. And he's constantly writing letters to the guys in charge of the air forces, wanting to know, basically, can he get a joyride in their plane? That, you know, if they're going to Point X, can I come along? Can you leave your observer behind? Can I come up for a flip with you? So it kind of plays to this idea, armored cars, fast cars, planes he likes. He starts moving in that direction. And really, he detaches from that kind of like the regular force that's going to move with Faisal and be very, quite formal, really. And then this other disparate, amorphous kind of force that's going to be a raiding force in the desert. So, yeah, I think it does hold true. But the only thing I will say about Seven Pillars of Wisdom, and trying to there's my copy there. Now, that's traveled all over the world with me. That has been out to the desert with me. It's a great book, but, you know, come to that with a certain amount of skepticism. Okay, if you got to write a history of everybody, if somebody came and said, look, Laurie, you can write a history of your life, you know, and I'll publish it for you, it would be a flattering one, wouldn't it? And that's very much the case with D.E. He writes a flattering history of his own life.
Our last question is going to come from Joe O'Farrell. Could you explain, David, why Trotsky disclosed the existence of Sykes-Picot agreement in November of 1918, and what was in it for the Russians?
Yeah, well, that's a simple enough answer. Mayhem. When you consider where the Russians are going at this time, and they're being certain amount of pressure from the French-British side to come back into the war, showing kind of like Allied duplicity, it all plays to their agenda. It gets pressure off them from the Allies. It kind of suggests then to everybody else fighting in the war, why are you doing this, comrade? You know, it's your enemy is not Germany. It is not France. Your enemy is, I mean, there's a great phrase that the Bolsheviks had, that a rifle is a weapon with a worker at both ends. Okay, a worker at both ends. And that plays into that whole psychology. Show up this, this is a total duplicitous agreement. It might collapse things in the Middle East, and it nearly does, from the Arab side. And in the general kind of like discussion about Allied command and Allied intentions post-war, this does not put them in a good light. So it suits the Bolsheviks to do this.
Dr. David Murphy, thank you so much. It has been an absolute delight. I hope you see the lovely comments that are pulling up here in the chat. And friends, to all of you who have joined us here live, and to those of you who are watching this at a later point on your time, thank you so much. The importance of history and how it impacts our art, how it impacts our present day, is so incredibly important. And we're thrilled that you are joining us at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and that you are joining the T.E. Lawrence Society for just another quick hour of learning a bit more on that. And again, take a look at those two titles. If you get a chance, buy that from your local bookstore. Dr. David Murphy, thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thanks for having me.